Fallout New Vegas is my favorite game of all time. Frankly, for all the other games I've talked about on this channel, there has never been a doubt in my mind as to which one I consider the best. Honestly, it's surprising even to me I haven't made any videos on it in the past, but the occasion has never truly come up until now. There's just so much content online on the topic, whatever I made would feel insignificant, or even worse, derivative. But today is the game's 10th birthday, and I think it's long overdue that I explain why it is so near and dear to my heart. So grab a fat, juicy Brahmin steak and a Chad Sunset Sarsaparilla instead of that virgin Nuka-Cola, and let's take a look at why Fallout New Vegas is the best game ever made. You're going to have to forgive me if I ramble on too much or forget some important details, because there's just so much I could talk about when it comes to this game. To me, New Vegas is above all else a wonderful example of an amazing RPG game, a smart game made by smart people, and I'll give examples as to why that is later on. But what I need to tell you right now is my first interaction with the game, because while many have heard about how great it is and have flocked to it for the immense RPG experience it offers, many already fans of the original Fallout games, hoping for a true successor after Bethesda's lackluster 3, my starting off point was as far gone from that as possible. I remember it like it was yesterday. The year was 2013, I had just finished playing Saints Row 4 and was looking for another game to play. I heard vague rumors of New Vegas being good, so I pirated it, because I was 13 and had no money for video games at the time, and clicked on that smiling vote boy to launch my game. The reason I mentioned playing Saints Row 4 right before was because of the jovial mood that game had put me in, making my first reaction to the NCR flag at the intro a wheezing laugh, as I thought it was two bears humping each other, not one irradiated bear with two heads. I was woefully unprepared for the experience I was about to have. But as the intro progressed and I got to see the streets of New Vegas, lit up in the middle of a silent black desert behind it, with the drunken NCR soldiers stumbling around while their Ranger superiors shot down Legion troops, the atmosphere of the game seeped into my mind. And when I faced the barrel of that 9mm pistol, I felt it hit me.
You got what you were after, so pay up.
You're crying in the rain, Pally.
Guess who's waking up over here?
Time to cash out.
Will you get it over with?
Maybe cons kill people without looking them in the face. But I ain't a fink. Dig? Made your last delivery, kid. Sorry you got twisted up in this scene. From where you're kneeling, must seem like an 18-carat run of bad luck. Truth is, the game was rigged from the start.
If you believed in a god, you'd think it was divine intervention. But god's an antiquity in the wasteland, one cast aside for more practical masters. You're dug up by some kind of robot and find yourself smack dab in the middle of the Mojave wasteland. From what you gather, the son of a bitch who did this to you resides in the jewel of this crown called New Vegas, the Strip. A place preserved from the atomic hellfire and standing out like a shining oasis with its high walls and big bright towers. A cat by the name of Mr. House owns this entire thing, and with the help of his army of Securitrons, has tamed three tribes and ascended them to influential families, all complete with their own big distinct casinos. Around that place is the not-so-fortunate part of Vegas, Freeside, a large and colorful ghetto with bustling small streets and businesses, with an even older castle in the middle, home to the followers of the Apocalypse, the closest thing to saints in the wasteland. Although even they have their own skeletons in the closet. This and more, though, are just background pieces to the main attraction, Hoover Dam. 4 years ago, the New California Republic and Caesar's Legion, from the west and east respectively, fought over this relic of immense importance. Although the NCR eventually won, both sides have dug into the very soil of the Mojave, and are fated to clash again, soon. But the war of these giants has stirred up the whole area. Local tribes, military groups, and forces that can stand up to the overextended armies of the East and West. But that doesn't matter to you. What matters to you is to get the piece of shit who shot you. And no matter where it takes you, what it takes you through, you got your eyes on the prize. The simplistic introduction of the courier, aka the player character in the game, serves to ease you into the scope of the conflict at hand. First, you get your basic method of hopefully beating Benny's brains out, then you encounter some local bandits. Safe in the knowledge that the whole town's got your back, you fend them off. Later though, as you make your way on the I-15 down to Prim, you have to save this town by yourself. You see, it didn't have a gunslinger like you around, so half of it got shot, the other barricaded in the casino next door. The NCR set up camp across the town, but they refused to aid.
I'm trying to get some reinforcements here, maybe some guns with some firepower, but shit. Things are just going slow.
You go in, rescue the deputy, then hit the road again. And just as you twirl your gun in your hand, full of confidence, you meet a euphoric member of the bandits you just battled across two towns. Yelling about some lottery, he passes you by, and you slowly turn your gaze to Nipton's main street, covered in bloodied men nailed on crosses. At the end of it stands a hooded man with red-cladded soldiers by his side. Thus, you are introduced to Kaisar's Legion.
Don't worry, I won't have you lashed to a cross like the rest of these degenerates. It's useful that you happen by. I want you to witness the fate of the town of Nipton, to memorize every detail. And then, when you move on, I want you to teach everyone you meet the lesson that Kaisar's Legion taught here. Especially any NCR troops you run across. Where to begin? That they are weak, and we are strong? This much was known already. But the depth of their moral sickness, their disillusion? Nipton serves as the perfect object lesson. Nipton was a wicked place, debased and corrupt. It served all comers, so long as they paid. Profligate troops, powder gangers, men of the Legion, such as myself. The people here didn't care. It was a town of whores. For a pittance, the town agreed to lead those it had sheltered into a trap. Only when I sprang it did they realize they were caught inside it too. I told them that when legionaries are disloyal, some are punished, the others made to watch. And I announced the lottery. Each clutched his ticket, hoping it would set him free. Each did nothing, even when loved ones were dragged away to be killed. Ha! Innocent. Hardly. Cowardly, though. They outnumbered us, yet not once did they try to resist. They stood and watched as their fellows were butchered, crucified, and burned. One by one, they stood and hoped their turn would not come. Each cared only for himself.
The intended beginning and first three towns perfectly introduced the main elements of New Vegas. Subtle escalation and entanglement in conflicts far behind you, a plethora of different paths to solve your problem, and the archetypal impressions of both the Legion and the NCR. Although encountered at the earliest and seemingly imposing with their tents and soldiers, the Republic forces are tied up in bureaucracy and are too busy to commit resources to auxiliary operations. The Legion, on the other hand, are thematically and strategically shown to be their exact opposites. Not defending, but attacking. Not passive and patient, but active and predatory. Savage in their methods, yet far better organized than simple bandits or raiders. While the NCR is stretched across the entire Mojave, the Legion controls very little territory, but its grip on it is iron. Even if Bethesda crippled Obsidian's development time and didn't allow them to develop the Legion as much in terms and quests and locations compared to the NCR, the writing team presented them in such a way as to make them mysterious and threatening, like a dark shadow looming across the other shore of the Colorado.
I used Imperial Rome as the model for my Legion precisely because it was so foreign, so alien. I'd seen what had become of the NCR's attempts to emulate the culture of pre-war America, the infighting. The corruption. Rome was a highly militarized autocracy that effectively integrated the foreign cultures it conquered. It dedicated its citizens to something higher than themselves. to the idea of Rome itself. In Rome, I found a template for a society equal to the challenges of the post-apocalyptic world, a society that could and would survive, a society that could prevent mankind from fracturing and destroying itself in this new world by establishing a new Pax Romana.
And while the player sees much of the stretched thin NCR army in the game, they only get glimpses of the Legion's hordes, for their power seeps into the Mojave either as a deadly ambush party or deeply entrenched spies around every corner. Should one choose to side with Caesar in the game, they can pretty much turn all the major NCR quests on their head, sabotaging the Republic's hold on the region from within. This technique turned what would otherwise be a hyped up enemy we never got to fear, as they are outnumbered tremendously by the NCR, into a foreboding presence one feels across the entire desert. This, and many different elements such as the absolutely fantastic voice acting.
They asked me how well I understood theoretical physics. I said I had a theoretical degree in physics. They said, welcome aboard.
And the fact New Vegas holds the Guinness World Record for the most lines of dialogue in a video game at around 65,000 reinforced the idea of a living, breathing world. While I was writing this, I even made a list of some of the many small little details that helped build up the Mojave. If you release the slaves at Cottonwood Cove, for example, they wind up at the old Mormon fort with the followers, because logically that group would take the best care of them. If you talk to Private Ortega at Sharecropper Farms after hunting down the fiends for bounties at Camp McCarran and ask her for a job, she will comment that somebody already took care of them. Furthermore, the reason this world that's actually smaller in size than Fallout 3's one is so rich and alive is that unlike that game or Skyrim, for example, with its huge map, you return to most locations many times. Outside of Megaton, Rivet City, and the DC Ruins, where else do you actively go to and from in 3? For all of the Elder Scrolls V's many dungeons, ruins, and villages, you go through them only once. Not only does New Vegas provide an organic way to circle around the map and thereby discover most of the important locations you'll be going back to, with all the other being a short ways away from the oval of now available fast travel locations, it also manages to provide a logical explanation for its design choices because, yet again, New Vegas is a smart game made by smart people. Why are you sent across the entire map to visit ranger stations? Well, because the quest is about station radios going haywire, and it also makes you trek across important paths with many events in between. Why can't I find the location of the Brotherhood of Steel? Well, because given the context of the game, they are extremely paranoid and in hiding. You may stumble across their location by accident, get clues about it from the in-game radio news broadcasts, or simply connect the dots and figure they'd be somewhere near their last battle at Helios 1. The way the reputation and skill systems work in New Vegas ensures that hubs or even small towns have practical uses, say for quests or supplies, but also that the criteria for said quests or services will have you back exploring the wasteland, not completing them in your one and only passing through the town. Say you don't meet a skill requirement to progress a quest. Well, you could search for a magazine to improve your skill, or simply check out another quest so you can level up. What if you don't have the reputation needed for a faction to trust you with more important matters? Just either do other missions so you gain their trust, or hide behind a disguise. But because New Vegas is a smart game, you may fool the grunts, but you can't use it on higher ranking officers, as that just would make sense. Also, something that is organically tied to this is the fact that just because you're liked by a certain faction, say the NCR, doesn't mean you are automatically disliked by another, even the Legion in some cases. So if you play your cards right, you could work for both of them, and only commit to a side further on, as you are essentially a mercenary at the start of the game.
Everything you've been up to, I just don't know what you're trying to pull.
Continuing with this trend, the reputation system itself isn't a binary thing. You have two columns, how much you've helped a faction and how much you've hindered or angered them. If you think about it, yes, choosing to allocate supplies to Freeside or other local communities instead of the NCR's armies will be seen as negative on the whole, but it doesn't make sense for them to turn on you when you've saved dozens of their troops in battle. All of these interactions are only possible because of the skill and special systems. When you start off, you will be asked to set your special points, These jovially stand for strength, perception, endurance, charisma, intelligence, agility, and luck. At first glance, you might think some of these are less important than others, but they form a very balanced system that offers unique experiences and content for almost any kind of character build, from the brute with low intelligence swinging a rebar club around, to the smooth-talking diplomat who can beat the entire game without killing a single enemy. Yes, that is completely possible, by the way, and in fact well documented in many True Nerds YouTube series. Even to the 10 luck high roller, who gets kicked out of the strip's casinos because he literally can't stop winning. This combined with the many specializable skills you can raise with every time you level up form a very customizable and rewarding experience. Not to mention the perk system, which can alter your game in tremendous ways, offering interesting and flavorful special abilities to spec into, compared to 3 and sadly 4's flat 10% this, 30% that. Throughout the course of the game, you will find yourself being presented with all kinds of skill checks. Repair to fix a vault's broken elevator and ease your journey, medicine to aid the lives of others, barter to arrange lucrative deals and speech to convince others. Most of these have very practical uses outside of specific interactions too, like giving you a bonus to how much you can heal or how much you pay for items at shops. So the combination makes most, if not all, skills equally viable, depending on your playstyle. I cannot stress enough how these interactions give incredible variety to the world, and this wouldn't be the case if they weren't so plentiful. It is the mark of a great RPG when you have interactions as rare and I guess you could say unbalanced, but nevertheless unique, fun, and realistic given the setting. From a business point of view, rewriting the entire dialogue for the Malkavian clan and VTMB wouldn't make any sense, as that content is only going to be seen by around 14% of the player base. But if you didn't do that, you wouldn't be able to portray the clan's madness convincingly, and would have an inferior game and experience subsequently. Similarly, playing as a female character and having the Seduction for Men perk, yes, there is one exclusively for women too, can skip you a significant portion of the game, because realistically in that situation, that'd be completely possible.
You're platinum, pussycat. You know how to swing. Nice Charlies, too. Give him a shake for the Ben man, will you? Hello.
The vast majority of quests in the game can be solved through a non-violent way, most and very clever ones at that, but if you want to tussle, well, you've got plenty of options. Be it a power fist that knocks out your opponent in one hit, or an anti-material rifle, which I always presume stood for, here is a material, aka thing, I want there to not be a thing here. The weapons in New Vegas serve their function splendidly. The gunplay is first person, but it retains a lot of its isometric core, having the damage be calculated based more on background stats than scope placement. The weapons you use, for being so low, degrade the more you use them, and it is your job to maintain them in the post-apocalypse, as well as your armor. Unlike Bethesda's Fallouts, where you get a mini nuke launcher at the first third of the game, or a fully functioning power armor suit in the very beginning, New Vegas withholds these powerful items. After all, you are but a simple mailman on a lonesome vendetta. Why would you come in contact with these things? Especially at random, like in the other games, given that anything worthwhile would have realistically been scavenged by now, or hidden extremely well. You do eventually, but only after you've earned them, and there are worthwhile enemies to use them on. Again, here we see that not only is there a reasonable explanation for why you won't find fully functioning pre-war technology in a desert that was nuked on top, but that this fact ties into the gradual escalation of the game, story, and difficulty Obsidian carefully planned for people patient enough not to require a big shiny new toy to constantly keep their attention. As to what difficulty I think is optimal for the game, normal is fine, but I do recommend you turn hardcore mode on, as it only reinforces the aforementioned realism. Stimpaks don't heal instantly, bullets weigh, and companions can permanently die, which, unlike Skyrim, actually means something. Contrasting 3 and Skyrim, New Vegas has less hard hands, or what those games would dare to call companions. What it has instead are true personalities you can come across, with their own distinct reasons to join you in backstories. They are fewer, yes, but that only means that you're expanded upon and fleshed out more. Every companion in the game has a unique quest you can unlock after you've gained their trust, be it in one way or the other, one which more importantly you can influence the outcome of and change the values and beliefs of those around you. This, of course, is coupled with what I think you're beginning to see as a theme, a practical skill, to complement their backgrounds. The doctor helps you heal for more, the sniper marks target for you, the mechanic maintains your guns. Get the picture. So even if you don't want to spend time in dialogue, these can help flesh out their personalities in combat. Even after close to 400 hours in this game, with no mods installed, I still find new locations and quests I never knew about before when I just go around one more corner. If I just take a slightly more roundabout way. Just a few days ago, I was walking from the Mojave outpost to Prim, and I noticed some random ghouls on my left. I killed them and looted some bottle caps. Now, I could have gone my merry way and never thought twice about it, but I started thinking, now, why would this many ghouls be here in the middle of the desert? And I started going backwards, towards where I saw there were more. Just over the hill, I saw a large irradiated lake and a shack at the end, offering an explanation as to where these enemies are coming from. The ghouls are there for a practical reason, to have something to fight in an otherwise barren stretch of the map and provide XP, but there was also thought behind their placement, and a reward for those immersed enough to delve deep and think logically enough to follow the trail. So far, I hope I've convinced you enough to play this game. Hell, the reason behind why I explicitly stated I pirated this game in the beginning was because if I didn't, at the time, I would never have played what would ultimately become my favorite game of all time, which I subsequently bought because I wanted to support the studio. From here on out, there will be minor spoilers, but even so, I still would suggest you keep watching. If not for YouTube analytics, then simply because unlike 3 and 4, who rely on a shocking twist to prop up the story, New Vegas plays a different game. It lays its cards out on the table for all to see, but it is in the decisions that you make, which are morally difficult, nuanced, and sometimes simply gut-wrenching, that the core of the engagement with the story lies. It is an active thing you choose to carry out as opposed to the passive reveal of information. But below all the gameplay lies something deeper. Something that, should you immerse yourself enough, will affect you whether you realize it or not. There are several games with good stories, RPGs with captivating choices and intriguing characters. But at the end of the day, that's all they remain. Interesting stories and the video games they are in, often as good as they are, still remaining just vehicles for the gameplay. There are, however, a small select few of these games, whose stories take on an archetypal meta-characteristic, one that transcends the game and comments on our real lives. The only examples I can think of off of the top of my head are Deus Ex and Planescape Torment, the latter of which was basically made by the same people that worked on New Vegas, so obviously it too falls into that list. To put it bluntly, the theme of Fallout New Vegas is moving forward. Almost every individual in the wasteland is affected by this contagious meme of clinging onto the past in one way or another. And throughout the story, the wasteland itself seems to reinforce the idea that only by examining our past, understanding it at its core, and then throwing away what didn't work, no matter how hard or painful it may be, can one make it in the post-apocalypse. The NCR, with all its territory and grand army, is literally repeating the mistakes of the pre-war United States to a T, seemingly hell-bent on blindly recreating the very institutions that led to the apocalypse in the first place. The Legion, ran by one of the most charismatic and interesting villains in modern video games, who shatters your expectations of a brutish oaf the moment he opens his mouth, clings to an ancient set of beliefs, which, even if powerful, crumble apart without their leader. For as much as he likes to imitate him, Caesar doesn't have an Augustus to his Julius, his only worthy successor lying burned to a crisp at the bottom of the Grand Canyon. The great Khans, scattered by bitter and long clashes with the NCR, hold on to that grudge and ally themselves with ones who would dissolve them as soon as they'd have the chance to do so. The Boomers and Brotherhood, paranoid and armed, hostile until the very end to outsiders and desperately relying on old texts written by those long gone. And the tribes that Mr. Howe civilized when awakening New Vegas too, unwilling to let go of their old nature, all in different ways, except for the chairman. But why? Well, because of Benny. In the comic that takes place before the beginning of the game, we can see how his tribe insisted on keeping their old rituals. But even if theirs were much more innocent than the other families, that would still be a remnant of the past, something to distract from moving forward, and so, even that had to be erased for the slate to be truly clean, for a baggageless journey into tomorrow. Even though he is the one true antagonist of New Vegas, the one player in the poker game whom it is necessary to eliminate, he is also one of the very few people who understand the theme of the wasteland. He is the one who sets up the path to the independent ending, and shows a drive, cunning, and wit very few people in the wasteland have. The true tragedy of New Vegas is you were simply caught in the crossfire and potentially go out to kill the one man who could have secured an independent and free Vegas out of spite. You, the courier, can also see past this romanticized past and move forward. And should you choose the independent ending, also fulfill some kind of poetic obligation to Benny by taking his place. This ability of yours as the player character extends to those you interact with. The more time you spend with them, the more you can set them free proverbially, and sometimes quite literally. And who do you spend more time with than your companions? Similar to how Chris Avalon wrote the Knights of the Old Republic 2's companions, whose destinies were shaped by your will, so are the paths of those in New Vegas. The difference here being that compared to KOTOR 2's vibrant locations in Galactic Adventure, the dry, draining, and harsh Mojave wears down all ambition, all enthusiasm. What you have in game are interesting people, with quite different stories, but all of them troubled by their past, with the hope for change or absolution subdued and drained out of them. Some haunted by past sins, such as the man who served with the Enclave, or the soldier who murdered innocents because he was ordered to. Others trying to save doomed enterprises with all the strengths they have left. Many of them you can stroke the fires of vengeance in to burn away the apathy in their souls. But you can also help them move on and transcend the endless cycle of treading the same old ground. Only when you have traveled long and far with them will they open up to you and ask for help. And only when you commit to a cause they believe in will they trust you enough to share their sins. And of course, if there is any character who chooses the future instead of the past besides you, your comrades in arms, and Benny, it's Mr. House. Connected to you before the game even began, before you knew of the Legion or NCR, before you stepped in New Vegas, before you even had the unfortunate fate to meet the wrong end of a 9mm, is your employer, the reason you were even carrying the Platinum Chip to begin with. And as your employer, he stays that way, issuing you orders and commandments from his literal ivory tower. But make no mistake, Robert Edwin House is no greedy bureaucrat, no vain warlord. He is perhaps the only visionary of his kind in all the wasteland from California to Boston. For as much as the Institute did with hundreds of scientists, and as much as the Enclave planned for all the years after the war, Mr. House outlasted both, and did it all alone.
You see that you and I are of a different stripe, don't you? We don't have to dream that we're important. We are.
From a young age, Robert House was cheated out of his family's wealth by his own brother, no less, after his parents' death. Alone, and left with pennies to his name, he took it upon himself to study and engineer fantastical robots and machines that would once again earn him wealth and fame, although at this point, the seeds of distrust for others and zealous self-reliance had already planted roots. During his time, the young House would fall in love with the city of Las Vegas, which took the place of lovers or friends within his heart. However, the determined mogul predicted the unfortunate end the world would soon meet and started preparing. His goal? The survival of Vegas, and from it, a new Eden from which life would restart after the war. He was prepared, although a single simple delivery, running late, prevented him from fully arming the Lucky 38's defenses. It was a matter of hours that separated a fully preserved Vegas from the rebel-filled streets that we see in-game. But Lady Luck was simply not with Mr. House that day, and as the bombs obliterated far more than was planned, he fell into a centuries-long sleep. This explains why he is so untrusting and dismissive of the courier, but also why he acts the way he does toward the wastes. Not only are the deserts of Nevada teeming with lawless rapists, bandits, and mercenaries, but those who manage to rise above their animalistic urges and wants delude themselves with the ways of the men who doomed the world in the first place. It insults him, for he has lived to see it all firsthand, and knows the past's idiocy and how to disregard its tempting call. What some may see in him as ruthless pragmatism, he sees as sacrifices necessary to preserve a mind of his magnitude, experience, and knowledge. For even the old Kimball, even the mighty Linnaeus are all but children to him, and at best could return life to a pre-war level if they can stop and cast aside their vanity and greed for a second, while House has a mind which could continue where the pre-war world left off and elevate humanity even higher. Prideful as he is, no other person can truly compare to House. Some have knowledge close to his, but lack the influence and power that he's earned. Others have armies that can conquer whole states, but will drive themselves into extinction out of ignorance and wrath. And so, it only makes sense that if any other group seeks to control Vegas, they'd have to get rid of him, the god of the strip. But a god he is not. And for all the things the man has single-handedly achieved, he has sacrificed much. The price of immortality is high. In the Fallout universe, the only things that live forever are horribly disfigured mutants or immobile ancients, locked forever in their tombs, projecting their will from an iron coffin of their own making. I legitimately cried when I had to kill Mr. House on my first playthrough, which I think serves as a testament to how immersive the game truly is. Even if it's for the greater good, even if it serves hundreds of lives, one cannot help but think that he's eradicating the last of the greatest minds in the world. The one beacon of hope that survived the war and persevered, only to be shot dead by a wastelander with petty politics on his mind. As I've been perusing YouTube videos and forum posts about New Vegas, it really dawned on me how immature some of the community is when it comes to House. He was an asshole, so I killed him. He was condescending, so he deserved to die. Perhaps I'm in the minority here, that very well might be true. But the lack of regret in those statements and their nonchalant nature makes me think these people truly don't understand that there is literally no mind to rival House left, and the situation that led to this genesis cannot be recreated to spawn another great visionary as he grew up in pre-war America. There will never be another Robert House. And even if the game requires you to put an end to him in most of the endings, it acknowledges the weight of your actions after you kill him, with a simple but utterly haunting message. Mr. House is dead. A tragedy has befallen all mankind. Over the course of 10 years, there have been thousands of videos covering specific aspects of New Vegas in more detail and depth than I ever could. From Oxhorn's meticulous documentation of almost every quest in the game, to William Strive's guides I enthusiastically pored over when I first started playing the game. Lest we also forget to mention the classics like Al Chestbreach and Mike Burnfire. But I'm relaying my own experience with the game here, and as subjective as that is, it wouldn't make sense for me to do anything else. I guess, in a way, the meta theme of New Vegas predicted something that ties back to it long before it ever actually happened. You see, Fallout 4 came out a few years after I had fallen in love with New Vegas. I followed every detail with ever-loving excitement in the days before its release. And even though the feeling of playing a brand new Fallout game on release was exhilarating and the gunplay was fantastic, it ultimately dawned on me. This just wasn't a Fallout game. The jokes about people calling Far Cry 3 Skyrim with guns were jokes no more because Fallout 4 was literally that. And even though I literally overclocked and subsequently bricked my laptop to play that game, remembering the theme of moving forward, I came to terms with it. I have felt many different things about that game. Hatred, anger, betrayal. But in the end, it's the same as with the new Star Wars movies. Move on. Let them be a reminder of the things that came before. Like how Rise of Skywalker made me buy the KOTOR games to experience an actually good Star Wars story. Or Fallout 4 made me search for other RPGs outside of the popular Bethesda titles. Appreciate it, come to know it, but do not be bound by the past. Recent news of Microsoft buying Bethesda, after having also acquired Obsidian the previous year, may have lit the spark of hope for Fallout New Vegas 2. But if you truly understood the first game, you know you shouldn't hope for that. We all want Obsidian to be given the proper time to develop the truly majestic RPG they're capable of. But one, you can't make a sequel to a game with such an open-ended finale that doesn't spit in the face of every choice you've made in New Vegas. And two, the people who made the game what it is just simply don't work at Obsidian anymore. John Gonzalez left a while ago, and Chris Avalon, well, let's just say he's had a hard life.
Hello, I'm Chris Avalon, literally the best video game writer of the entire industry. What's that? LucasArts wants me to write a sequel to the Knights of the Old Republic in a year and a half and under budget while the first game took 3 years to make? Those are tough conditions, but what's that? Oh, you cut our dev time at about a half because of changing management in LucasArts? Well, holy shit, I don't know how we'll manage. I guess I'll pump out one of the best written RPGs in history. Oh boy, I sure hope something like that doesn't happen again. What's that? Bethesda wants us to make a sequel to Fallout 4 in about a year and a half and under budget? Well, those are tough conditions, but what's that? They rushed us so we had to cut about half of the Legion content in the game? Dang it, gang, I don't know how we'll manage this time. It seems the only course of action left is to
create the single best role-playing game of all time.
What's that? Paradox Interactive, we're making a sequel to Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines? Oh well, I sure hope I can work on a faithful successor to a classic and beloved RPG and some unbanked controversy doesn't conveniently come up and the studio removes all my contribution to a project that literally depended on it to be any fucking good.
Keep in mind that I am in no way discrediting Josh Sawyer, who is still at Obsidian and was an integral part of what made New Vegas so good, but with the Outer Worlds being mediocre at best, I think we need to move forward and not cling to the mystical savior that is a potential Fallout New Vegas 2, instead creating our own future, which may be different from the ones envisioned, but great nonetheless. For example, it was exactly my disappointment with Bethesda that led me to discover a new, totally different game series I could gush over and fall in love with, that being Devil May Cry, and I'm sure if one doesn't lose hope, they can find their own new love, just as I unexpectedly did. At the end of the day, Fallout New Vegas is my favorite game of all time, although throughout the years I have lessened the overpowering enthusiasm with which I force it upon my friends, as you need to voluntarily ease yourself into the dense atmosphere and rugged charm of it all, lest you dive too deep too quick and failed to grasp the subtleties. Truth is, I didn't like the game at the start. Honestly, I can't tell you when New Vegas got me hooked, but somewhere along that road, I knew it had left its mark on me. The game taught me a lot of things, from learning that you spell I with a capital letter to app ruminations that deeply affected me, to how to appreciate a truly good RPG. The memories I have with it would stay with me forever, and even after the video game industry is filled completely with derivative, two-dimensional retreads of tales told a thousand times over, the Lucky 38 will still be there, shining like a star, and standing out for all to see from near and far, calling out to all that if they want to have a good time, New Vegas is the place to be.
By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion.